Let me put it into the share mode. Can you see my desktop now? Hello, guys.
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Okay. So I'll start with discriminant analysis. So just a minute. Okay. Suppose, so this one I have, my notes is based on K class classification, but if K is a 2, K is 2, that means it's a binary class classification. It will be binary class classification, like yes, no, approve, reject, this kind of thing. Okay. Now, on each class, we will start with a probability of pi k, which is probability of k, basically prior probability of k. And then given the features, can we update the posterior probability of a particular test point belongs to k? Okay. And that you can do using simple Bayes theorem, that class conditional probability is basically distribution is your likelihood function. Effectively, this is my likelihood, right? And then fkx times pi k, and then you just take the normalizing constant below. That will give you the posterior probability of a particular test point belongs to class k. So it is highly important that you somehow you actually model it pretty well, and then only so modeling this likelihood correctly is also very important actually. Now people try many things to model these if likelihood fkx, the class conditional distribution, but we will typically the most in the linear discriminant analysis, it assumes multivariate Gaussians on X. And if you take in the X, if you take the covariance matrix to be sigma, okay, then you can come up with a linear discriminant function. And this basically gives you the, if you for two function, it will give you this linear equation will give you effectively the discriminant decision boundary between K, class K and class L. Now, if you take sigma K equal to sigma, that means all the class has the same covariance matrix, same variability, same covariance, then your decision boundary turns out to be a simple straight line. As you know that log pi k is constant, you can treat it as a constant. Now covariance inverse times mu k also treat as a constant, then it will behave like your intercept or some sort of a right way of saying it, some sort of a bias in the in machine learning terminology, it will because we have like a bias. And then sigma inverse mu k, if you come, this is your weight actually, and then x transpose of weights is weight is sigma inverse mu k plus bias. So that is what the entire, so that means it's a basically a linear function. So, and then or the decision boundary of mu delta kx, and then you take the one that function which has the maximum of the delta k. So that is what typically the linear discriminant analysis works. Now, in standard packages, what we use is, in the linear decision function, we have to basically estimate the pi k, mu k, and sigma. So what we do, we use the maximum likelihood estimates. And for sigma, we use this pooled covariance matrices. Okay. Now, and that is, these estimates are maximum likelihood estimates. Remember that. So here is an interesting thing that I actually never been tried, but you guys can try and check it out whether it actually helps or not. You can try Bayes estimate on pi, Bayes estimate on mu and sigma. Okay. And that can be, and then you can try a simulation study and check if Bayes estimates actually helps improving the predictive power of linear discriminant analysis than off the shelf maximum likelihood estimates. Okay. So this is just a problem statement. I just tell you, but not necessarily. I have not seen much. If my educated guess is it will help, but typically I have not seen it. But and most of the time I have seen, what I have seen is people do use off the shelf maximum likelihood estimates, okay, for linear discriminant analysis. QDA, the quadratic discriminant analysis, is same thing, but the function now become a quadratic in nature, in because now you don't make this assumption. Only difference is in the linear discriminant analysis is sigma k equal to sigma, equal covariance matrix, same covariance matrix for all classes. Whereas in the QDA, you are assuming that each class has its own covariance matrix. So it results into a explosion of the parameter estimation problem. So it's done it of, for a small sample, it will run into little bit high dimension problem. I mean, number of parameter will explore it's at a quadratic rate. I think definitely at a quadratic rate. But and that might result into some degree of overfitting. But I don't know yet. I have not seen any work or paper which says maybe, okay, if you use a Bayes estimate for sigma k inverse or mu k, that will actually improve your performance. So if somebody is interested exploring this, write me, we can talk separately. This is not part of the, I don't want to push you into some unknown horizon. Because it's a proper, it's just a course. If somebody is interested, I would be happy to discuss. Okay. So this is LDA, QDA. Now I'm want to move on to logistic regression for and how to implement the Bayesian technique for logistic regression with RobitClick. Now, typical off-the-shelf statistical library will implement the logistic regression with LogitLink. Okay. And you know that another alternate link function is ProbitLink. Now, in Bayesian methodology, ProbitLink is more popular than the LogitLink. Why? Because for ProbitLink, Gibbs sampler exists. For the LogitLink, the Gibbs sampler does not exist. If you want to implement logistic regression with logit link, you have to write a MCMC algorithm. But if you want to implement logistic regression with probit link, you don't have to implement the MCMC algorithm or Metropolis Hastings. I mean, both Metropolis and Gibbs are actually MCMC. You don't have to write the Metropolis algorithm. It's a simple existing Gibbs sampler will work very well. So let us discuss this logistic regression with logit link. Okay. All right. Suppose we have a data set D, which has some yi and xi, I equal to 1 to n. So that means that you can imagine a data set which has n rows and p plus 1 column. First p columns are x1, x2, xp, and this vector represents the ith row. Okay, and the p plus first column, the last column, is the y variable. It's marked as 1, 0, success or failure, approved or reject, something like that. Okay. Now, how you model the binary response model? The simple logistic regression probit with probit model will be probability of yi equal to 1 equal to capital phi of xi transpose beta, and yi equal to 0 will be phi of minus xi transpose beta. And I'll explain you how the things are works. What we do here to how we I'm going to explain you this in order to how we reach here is something called a data augmentation technique. So what is a data augmentation technique? So what we do first, we say that this xi transpose beta is actually part, we can model it as zi equal to xi transpose beta plus epsilon I. Okay, and epsilon I follow normal 0, 1. And then we say that, you know what, we actually don't know what is zi. We have not observed zi. But if zi is greater than 0, then we observe 1. And if the zi is less than 0, then we observe 0 for yi. So we are observing yi equal to 1 and 0. But the 1 happens when zi is positive, and 0 happens when zi is negative. Okay, very good. Then what happens is, you can ask me, what is the rationale behind this probit model? The rationale behind this probit model is something like, comes from the economics. Suppose you want to buy, say, a mobile phone, right? So what you do, you actually go to the market, you go to a shop, you look 3-4, you have some budget in your mind, right? That, okay, this is my budget. Then what you do, you look within that budget, you tell the customer, okay, give me some mobile phone, show me some mobile phones within around this budget, and the shop owner will show you some mobile phone from different makers. And then you will compare the features of how it looks, how it feels, what are the, you know, technical features. You will compare them. These features are X1, X2, XP. Okay. These features are X1, X2, XP. You have some model in your mind, you fit in there, and that gives you a sample. Given where, then you ask yourself, give the money that you are going to pay, whether that, given that money, whether your utility out of that, those features, the pay money you pay for it, is on the positive horizon or in the negative horizon. So Zi can be viewed as the utility that you will derive out of this feature on this phone. Now this, if this utility is positive, you will buy the phone or you will not buy the phone. If it is negative, then you will not buy the phone. Okay, so this is the idea of you know, augmented data augmentation. Here utility, we cannot really say, we cannot put a number. So utility or Zi are often known as something called latent variable. Okay, and this latent variable method is extremely popular and extremely powerful if you can apply it in correct way. Particularly this kind of categorical variable, if you try to model categorical variable, this latent variable modeling technique is extremely useful. So our probit model, we can say, we can define it typically is Zi equal to Xi transpose beta, epsilon I, and epsilon I follow normal 0, 1. Now we can say that the observed data is like Yi equal to 1, 0, Zi greater than 0, Zi less than 0. So the parameter space is basically beta, and on the beta, we put some, say, Gaussian distribution with beta 0, lambda 0. We know the conditional posterior distribution of beta given Z, Y, and X is follow posterior distribution with some posterior mean and variance. And posterior mean, you can write it in this way, with where beta hat is X transpose X inverse X transpose Z, and lambda n is lambda naught inverse X transpose X. Remember that this solution does involve Z. Okay, so we have to be a bit careful how we will do that. So how Gibbs sampler works? The way Gibbs sampler works is something interesting. So first you choose some initial value of beta. Say suppose you have, I mean, you choose anything like 0, 0, 0 or 1, 1, something, some initial values for beta. And then the iteration start, m equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. And the mth iteration, you sample the Zm from a truncated normal 0 to infinity. When, so you can define a truncated normal distribution. Truncated normal distribution is a proper probability distribution over Zi with mean Xi transpose beta, when you are taking beta to be the last beta, simulated beta, comma 1, if Yi equal to 1, and or you simulate Zm from a negative truncated normal distribution on the negative support if Yi equal to 0. So, and then given the Zm, you simulate the beta m, and then you go to the second next iteration, and you keep doing it, and that's it. That's the all the thing, and that's how you just simulate from the beta and you are done. And that's how logistic regression with probit link are being implemented in.
So can you explain the second step? I missed.
So your posterior distribution, if you choose a prior distribution to be normal, so this is a simple regression model. Zi follow normal, Zi is equal to Xi transpose beta plus epsilon I, where epsilon follow normal 0, 1. So it's a simple regression model where you know sigma equal to 1. And then on beta, you choose beta naught to be beta, for it follows normal beta naught lambda naught, where yi's are zi greater than zero. If it is zi greater than zero, then it is one, or zi less than zero, then it is zero. So the model run, and given the z, y, and x, the posterior distribution, conditional posterior distribution, is again normal because of the conjugate distribution results. Okay, where my beta hat, the posterior beta hat, is x transpose x inverse x transpose z, and lambda n is lambda n naught inverse x transpose x, and you just, this is my posterior beta, and this is posterior mean of the beta, and this is the posterior covariance of the beta. So overall, I know how to simulate from the posterior Gaussian normal, multivariate Gaussian. I know how to simulate, and I know that posterior distribution of beta is multivariate Gaussian. So all I have to do in this step, I have to simulate from the multivariate Gaussian, whose posterior mean is this and posterior variance is this, which is available in the mathematically closed form solution. Only things that is not available is the value of Z. So how you simulate Z? So basically you simulate Z from a truncated normal when the Z is between 0 to infinity, if yi is 1, if you have observed yi equal to 1, then you simulate zi from a truncated normal with a support between 0 and infinity with xi transpose beta, basically from this model. So for this model, what we are saying that zi in this part, zi is a truncated normal with a support between 0 to infinity.
Does it have to be truncated normal, or like can we assume any other which has similar?
It has to be, because you are saying epsilon I follow normal 0, 1, that will induce a normal on zi.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. Then you are saying y equal to follow 1 if zi greater than 0. So it has to be, that means you are truncating that normal between 0 to infinity. So when yi is 1, you cannot observe zi to be negative value. So you want to make sure that you are observing a positive value. In order to make sure you are observing a positive value, you want to impose that condition that, okay, you simulate from the normal, but it is truncated normal. It is between 0 and infinity. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So that is what the simple algorithm is. So we are not going to implement this algorithm. I think there is off-the-shelf algorithms are available. We are going to use that. Okay. So this is, I think, the result. This is the problem. There is a birth weight data set in the mass package of R, and the data set tries to look for risk factor associated with low infant birth weight. And we model that zi equal to beta naught plus beta 1 age, beta 2 race is black, race is others, and then smoke is yes, no. And some epsilon I, we assume epsilon I to be normal 0, 1. So basically you want to compute probability low equal to 1, given the age, race, and smoke status, what will be the probability that the birth weight of a infant will be less than 2.5 kg. So here was, since it was a Gibbs sampler, it was very nicely behaved. Convergence was fast, very nicely behaved thing. Posterior distribution was also very nicely behaved, normal type behavior we are seeing. But it is near zero, so that means intercept is near zero. Then age does have effect, sort of a negative effect. If mother's age is high, that means, that indicates that the chance that the infant will be low birth weight, have a low birth weight, is slightly higher. Then if the smoke turns out, if the smoke is positive, then the if the smoke is positive, then the low birth weight will be higher, on chance of low birth weight on the positive side. That means it will have a high chance that it will be low birth weight.
Sir, so does this smoke variable refer to the smoking habits of the parent?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, smoke is, smoke equal to yes, no kind of thing. So there were, these are the, you check it out, birth weight. I think if I have this, so I have this thing. Let me see if I have the, I have the board in my old laptop. So I am actually in transition between my new to old laptop. So old to new laptop, and some of my codes are in the old laptop and some of the here. But yeah, so library, mass, we have the, I think birth weight. So mother's race, smoke status during pregnancy. So yeah.
Only mother, not. I think this is the data for the mother.
Not both parent. It is only for the mothers. Yeah. It's only on the mothers. Yes. Like HT stands for history of hypertension. I think, but this is only with the mothers. Yes. So that's the data set that we are going to explore. Let me just a minute. Okay. I think we have the I'm in a class. Can I talk? Okay. I think the code that I am looking for is data. Okay. Classification. Put it somewhere here, maybe. This one take files. Okay, it requires MCMC pack install. So as I said that it's a new laptop, so many things are not there actually in place. So, okay, here is the code. So I'm using the MCMC pack. Set.sed. All right. John Hinkle, Andrew Martin. Yeah, this is the group. And then the number of sample is, I think, 189. I just saw. Keeping. And then I'm just splitting it into train and test. And then I'm running a linear discriminant analysis on them. And predicting the new class on the, and here is the confusion table. Okay. And here is the accuracy model of LDM, which is 67%. If I write a naive model saying everybody is low, and then also I'm saying that, okay, 67% are naive model means where I'm saying every test points are, I'm saying that they have a low birth weight, all the test cases. So there's a naive model. In that case also 67% is the accuracy of the model. And then, so there's basically, that means linear discriminant analysis with this two factor, race, age, and smoke, does not have much of a predictive power. So you need either to do some data engineering, feature engineering, or the variable transformations, or add some new, you have to look for some new predictor which might help you. Okay. Accuracy of the naive model turns out to be better, in fact. So in MCMC pack library, there is a something called MCMC probit. Okay, the probit model, logistic regression with probit link. So that's why they named it MCMC probit. And there, all you have to do, you have to just say MCMC probit the same way we in LM, we the way we did give the most define the variable models like low as a function of race, age, and smoke. And race variable will be as a factor variable, not as a, because race is defined as 1, 2, 3, but 1, 2, 3 should not be treated as a numeric, it should be treated as a categorical variable. So you need to just define it as a factor. And of course, birth weight as a, the training model, zero, beta naught is zero in the initial values. These are the prior values with, and B0 is the, I'm giving covariance to be starting with 10, 10 and covariance to be zero. And then I'm saying first.
Sir, just one question. Shouldn't we consider smoke to also be a factor because it has only two levels, right? 0 and 1.
Since it's only two levels, 0, 1, it will not be that of a problem. But if you have a 0, 1, 2, then it will be a problem. In any way, you understand what I'm saying? Sure. Yeah, so burn-in is 3,000 and after burn-in, you simulate 30,000 MCMC samples. So if you run this immediately, it ran very fast. And so if you do out, so these are the samples that have been generated. Okay. And if you do a summary of this, so this is the summary. Like when I'm saying mean, it is the coefficient mean. This is standard deviation. That means it's basically, if I run the same model with LM, okay, let me just run the same model with LM and I'll tell you, then it is actually comparable. The summary and thing is actually comparable. And then with this. Summary. See, this is my or let me just say coefficients. I think that will be better to compare. Okay. Now let us compare apple to apple mismatches. So my intercept in the LM model turns out to be 0.25. Here it turns out to be very close to zero, negative 0.04, with a standard error of 0.273. This is we calling standard deviation of the posterior distribution, and here standard error is 0.195, so somewhat little higher, and the t value is 1.28. at a 5% level we cannot reject null, so that means intercept is somewhat meaningfully close to zero. Now there are two rays, 2 and 3, we call them black and other. Here estimates turns out to be 0.142 and with a standard error 0.122. Here it is come out to be 0.122 and 0.231, and others it came out to be 0.246, whereas it was 0.2, near about 0.2. So and turns out here in all these three race does not have an effect on the birth weight of the infant. That is what we are seeing here in this case, whereas here in this one in LM is saying the others may have a little bit of effect, okay, compared to the blacks. So age does not have a here age, it's saying age does not have an effect, 0.005 and thing, but here it is saying age base interval is base confidence interval is saying age may have an effect, that if you have too much, if the mother's age is too high, if infant may have a little bit of less birth weight. And smoke, here they are saying that smoke definitely has an effect, and here also Bayes model is saying smoke definitely has a effect, positive effect. Like, you know, if you have a, so smoke equal to one, then low equal, how we define the model, we define low equal to, let me just birth weight. So we define low equal to one if the birth weight is less than 2.5. And if the smoke is one, if the mother's birth weight is, mother is a smoker, then basically I'm saying if the smoke equal to one, the chance that the low birth weight, you will see a low birth weight in the infant is very high, significantly high. On the other hand, age, if the, is we are seeing, according to Bayes model, it's saying we are somewhat negative relationship. And it's saying that if the mother's age is higher side, then you will see the low birth weight is on a chance is less. That means it is more, if the mother's is at a high, like if it is on the other way to frame it, if it is a young mother, the chance of seeing a low birth weight is higher. We can say it in that way also. In fact, in United States, that, you know, single mother, teenage mother, that probability, that are being often being seen in many parts, and that often is a case. Actually, not in US, it is indeed the case in even in the low-income groups, low-income countries as well, including India. So we have always seen that the low birth weight of infant is much higher chance with teenage mothers and the mothers with, you know, young mothers. So both these two observations sort of conform with what is our common knowledge, common wisdom. Bayes model says that race does not have an effect, whereas simple linear model, linear regression model, is indicating that race might have some effect, weak effect, but it's not very confident. Like at 3%, like p-value is at 3%. So that means if I'm keeping level of significance at a 5%, then I will reject, but at a 1% level, we will not reject. So it's better. So whereas here we can say for significantly that race does not have any effect. So that's an interesting, so this is what we can stop here. Then I have done some basically visualization. So like this, I have done, okay. I think I need a little bit space, then a little bit more space. Yeah. Then this is another, this is for intercept, I think. And then this is for age. This is for age. This is for smoke. Now we are trying to say also the prediction of probit regression. Also we have done. So and then did some confusion metrics for the probit model, and the accuracy also we computed and calculated. So the naive model's accuracy 714 turns out for linear discriminant analysis is turns out to be 67%, and the probit model is 71%. So it's at least the probit model is doing as good as the naive model than the off-the-shelf LDA. Remember that LDA does use that MLE estimates. My educated guess is if we use Bayes estimates, it might actually help. Okay. So I will share this code you on the Moodle as I always do. So I'm stop sharing now and make I'll share this code and I will also assign the next assignment. I have started evaluating your mid-sem exam. I'm as I committed by tomorrow, I will try to finish the mid-sem exam evaluation, and then I will start evaluating the assignment, the last, the one you will submit by tomorrow. And then I will also assign the second assignments, hands-on assignments. Okay. Any question you guys have?
Sir, this is just to confirm about the assignment. So we can just submit a notepad file with all the questions, with all the R codes, right?
Like correct.
Okay.
Dot R file will be good enough.
Okay.
Yeah. So you can also submit it as a .txt file, but dot R file is easy to run in R notebook. So okay, that is good enough. Yeah. Just mention in each code snippets, before the code snippets, you just mention the problem.
The question number.
Question number and little bit of the, also whatever your comment, if you want to say something, put it into the non-executable comment.
Okay.
Yeah.
I had a question. So it wasn't fully clear to me how you were gauging the significance in the probit model. So when you said that we can see that race is not significant there.
Okay. I'll show you. So
another thing. So here the accuracy naive is the same thing as we saw last time, right? The fact that they're equal to six significant figures probably means that there's an error, right? Accuracy naive and accuracy probit. The last time accuracy naive 6-1 or something. So I think it should have been the same, right? When you showed us before.
Okay. So I'll share the maybe there is a
bug. Anyway, this is not very important, but the other question is something I'm confused about.
So let me just explain you a little bit about this significance level. Are you familiar with the testing of hypothesis?
The linear regression is fine. So you just look at the t statistic and.
Correct. So, I'll. That is what I'm going to explain you. I'm just want to write, print that summary and the. Yeah. Okay. So this part you are fine, right? This is you know how to do into the t value and the p value, and you can do that. Correct. Okay. Then the summary, how just looking at this, how can I make this significance test?
Yeah, that wasn't
decision. So you see here, I'm not giving, I'm just giving you 95% interval to you, 2.5% and 97.5%. So I'm just giving you 95% interval to you. So if I have to calculate, say, 95% interval for this model, so how I will do is basically I will take this value, okay, and then say 1.96 times standard error. If I just do that, so this will be my lower interval, 2.5%. And same thing if I just do for plus, that will be my upper interval. Okay. Now you can show that 5% level of significance. So actually it's basically dual of 5% level of significance of testing of hypothesis problem is a dual problem of 95% confidence interval. Okay. So what I mean by that, is if I reject null hypothesis based on p-value, then my confidence interval, the way I created here, will also not include the zero. So let me explain it to a little bit with more clarity. So for example, smoke, correct? You see smoke t-value is 3.09 and p-value is 0.0024. Now, if I take the estimates of smoke, subtract 1.96 times 95%, I want 95% confidence interval, this comma smoke plus 1.96 times standard error. This I am putting it into C. So this is my confidence interval. And look, this confidence interval is a 95% confidence interval for these parameter estimates, and it does not include zero. And this confidence interval is a one-to-one mapping of this t value and statistics. It's, you can show basically, right? So if you reject null hypothesis at a 5% level of significance, the 95% confidence interval will also not include zero. What is null hypothesis? The null hypothesis is the coefficient corresponds to smoke is zero. Alternative is coefficient corresponds to smoke is non-zero. Your p-value is too small, t-value is too high, you're rejecting null hypothesis. That is typical testing of hypothesis problem. I can do the same decision, just saying that my confidence interval for beta does not include zero, hence I reject null hypothesis at 5% level, where my confidence interval is at 95% interval. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So that is what exactly I am doing here. So I'm just looking at the confidence interval. So this confidence interval does include zero. So I fail to reject null. This also includes zero. I fail to reject null. This also includes zero. I fail to reject null. This does not include zero. Its entire interval is on the left side of the zero. Hence, I reject null and I say it does have effect on null on birth weight. Okay.
So as a, I mean, from the Bayesian point of view, zero is not like a special hypothesis, right? The fact that
I'm using 95% Bayesian interval to take a decision whether it has an effect on significant effect or not. This is not the classical way of, I mean, typical Bayesian testing technique. I'm just, it's a like dirty way of doing a quick, if I have to take a quick decision.
Yeah.
Right. One quick decision is I will just look into the Bayesian interval. I will say that, okay, does it include zero? No. So that means it has a significant effect on my birth weight. Very easy to interpret. and it solves my problem. Of course, if you want to do a proper testing of hypothesis in a Bayesian way, you would like to do either do it using Bayesian information criteria, or you would like to use compute Bayes factor.
Right.
Right. I have not gone in that route. I have done it in a much more easy, simple route, but I'm just saying that you compute the 95% Bayesian interval. You just check in your Bayesian interval include zero or not. If it does not include zero, then at a high level of confidence, you can say that that parameter does have an effect on your target variable, or that predictor does have an effect on your your target variable.
Right, I see.
That is my way of, I mean, and I have presented it to many, you know, professors, senior professors, and they all fine with it. I mean,
I see.
That is perfectly fine. This is if I have to write a paper, probably I would also report Bayes factor.
Right, I see.
You understand what I mean, right? If I have to write a paper, I will, of course, I will here, I will add another column which report the Bayes factor for each of these guys. Okay. But I have not done that yet.
That makes it very clear. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Any other question? If not, then let's stop here. I think two major topics are now left. One is hierarchical modeling, Bayesian hierarchical modeling, and testing of hypothesis. I think we have enough time, and rest of the time, as I said, so slowly in 1 week, we will do the testing of hypothesis, another week we will do the hierarchical modeling, and of course, we'll do a lot of hands-on. Each day we will do lots of hands-on. Okay. All right, guys. Thank you very much. Take care.
Thank you, sir. Sir, are you free for 5 to 10 minutes after class?
Wait, sure.
Okay, sir.
You can call me.
Yes. Okay, sir.
Okay. Bye.